Boys, you going to help? Need some help? Well, it's that time of the year again. First of the year, amen? I've got our annual prayer requests and also who you're praying for. I hope you're praying for people to get saved. I heard a few amens out there. Y'all praying for people to get saved? I hope so. And I'm sure you're probably coming into the new year with a lot of prayer requests. I love to do this annually because it gives us an idea of, hey, what we're trusting in God to take care of this coming year. So I'd encourage you, might not have a pen with you, but be praying about this. This morning in the Holy Spirit, I was talking and just really, you know, what am I going to be praying for coming? What am I hoping for God to take care of coming into this new year? And it's not a secret. I'm actually praying for the direction of my children. And specifically things for each one of them, the direction in their lives and how God's going to form them and develop them. I think our young people have a bright future this year. Amen. And I think God's going to be doing some mighty things among our youth. So my heart, my prayer is actually for my kids and their directions. I don't know what yours is. Maybe it's a little bit more personal. I don't know. Whatever it is. This year, I pray you just lay it in the hands of Jesus, place it at the feet of Jesus, and just wait and see what, and He's going to answer, amen? You believe that? You trust Him to do that for you? Then also, not only that, be praying. I hope that you have at least three people on your heart. You know, it was actually, this morning, I had a few people that were on my heart, but I have a couple more slots open. I have actually more than three, amen, but I hope that you're actively engaging the community for Christ, praying for people, because there's no other hope other than Jesus. Amen? So you guys keep this to your heart this year, and when God, just go ahead and put them there. That's great, guys. Thank you so much. Appreciate y'all. Amen? Give it up for the men. Amen. I say that because they're near men, aren't they? Not yet, boys. Amen, but getting there. Proud of y'all. Thank y'all for serving. But I want you to be praying for what God is going to do for you in this new season. But let's, before we open up this word, hey, let's pray and ask Him to help me here. Let's pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, this morning we say thank You for already what You're doing in song and in teaching and in fellowship. Thank You for the opportunity. Lord, You were resurrected on this day, and that's why we're celebrating it. We're celebrating the Resurrection Day. We're celebrating the fact that You're alive and with us. And we have newness of life, and we have life. And we get an opportunity to gather as the body, as Your family, and as Your bride, one another, Lord, to meet with one another and sing with one another and encourage one another. And God, just be encouraged by You today. So, Lord, I pray that, Holy Spirit, that You would speak to every heart and mind in this room. Lord, let them know that You have a bright hope and a future for them this year, and You're going to hear those prayers, and You're going to answer them. And Lord, it might not be in our timing, but I pray we hold on to this, and when it does, we rejoice, and we give You testimony, we give You praise for what You've done in our lives. So Lord, I just pray that every heart and every mind in this room is focused solely on You right now and on Your Word, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen, church?
Amen.
Well, if you will, turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 20. I love this story, and there are so many takeaways from this story. I'm not going to put a theme on you. I know that you're going to come up with your own theme for these verses this year, but let's go ahead and stand for the reading of God's Word. We're going to start this year out right, starting in Matthew 20, starting in verse 20, Matthew 20, 20. It says, "Then the mother of Zebedee's sons came to Him with her sons kneeling down and asking something from Him. And He said to her, 'What do you wish?'" What do you want? What are you praying for here? "She said to Him, 'Grant that these two sons of mine may sit, one at your right hand and the other on your left, in your kingdom.' But Jesus answered and said, 'You do not know what you're asking here. Are you actually able to drink the cup that I am about to drink and be baptized with the baptism that I'm about to be baptized with?' And they said to Him, 'We're able.' So He said to them, 'You will indeed drink my cup and be baptized with the baptism that I am to be baptized with, but to sit on my right hand and on my left is not mine to give, but is for those for whom it is prepared by my Father.' And when the 10 heard it, they were greatly displeased with the two brothers. But Jesus called them to Himself and said this, You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who are great exercise authority over them. Yet it shall not be so among you. But whosoever desires to become great among you, let him be your servant. And whoever desires to be first among you, let him be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Father, I pray that we see that you've done it first for us. I pray that we don't come at it with an idea or mentality that, Father, there's really anything to gain but you. Lord, I pray that we can serve as you have served us. That, Lord, we can love as you have loved us. The Father, no matter what comes our way, we know that you're going to take care of us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen, church? You may be seated. So this morning, I know I've talked about this verse in the past, and it's really a pretty interesting verse. Now, these are the sons of Zebedee. Now, the sons of Zebedee had a nickname. They're called the sons of thunder. And a lot of times, I'm looking at Joe and Buddy, and I think in the past, y'all could have been called the sons of thunder. Amen? You see these men, they were men of power, right? You didn't mess with them. You messed with one, you messed with both. Amen? And they were called, Jesus, they had a nickname, they're called the sons of thunder. And their mama was just as thunderous. Amen? Amen. Amen. She still is. Hallelujah. Hey, and it's not wrong to go to Jesus and ask him for things. Hallelujah. But Jesus kind of brings up this fact that it has to be from a heart, right? A right heart. If you see this, the very end here really proves what I'm trying to get to this morning. Look in verse 28. It says, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. Really, I want you to know this, that we can only serve coming into this year, okay, because Jesus first serves us. Hallelujah. You can't help but serve until you know that Jesus first served you. You can't help but love others unless you first know that Jesus loves you. You really can't love others the way that you need to until you understand God's love for you. Amen? Otherwise, you might come at it with a wrong kind of an attitude, thinking that there's some kind of power or authority or pomp and circumstance that you're going to get along the way. Look, and this is pretty remarkable. I'm just saying, Wednesday night after y'all left, it was like right after the last one of you left, the phone rang. Just some random guy. And it come to find out, he was struggling in his life, and he told me his backstory about what him and his girlfriend did during New Year's Eve. Very graphic. And was actually looking for some help. And I said, well, how'd you get my number? He said, I just dialed. And I guess God brought you to me. Honestly, this guy randomly dialed this number. And my whole point to him at the end of the story was, you can't help but love one another the way you should love one another until you know God's love for you. If you don't know that God loves you, you can't help. You just can't. And you don't have the ability to love others the way you should love them until you know how great of a love God has for you. Amen? You know, David was talking about love this morning. Love was on your heart. But we honestly can't serve one another. We can't love one another like we should until we know that God truly loves us first. Amen? Do you know that God loves you? Do you know that Jesus came to serve you first? And a lot of times we have this arrogance thinking that, oh, look at what I'm doing for Jesus, or I need to do this for Jesus, or I need to do this for Jesus. And yes, we need to serve alongside of him, amen? But he first has gone before us, hallelujah? And he first did it for us. He's the one that carried the burden on Calvary, amen? He was the one that showed and extended his love and his service to us. And if we can comprehend that, y'all, it's going to be better for us, hallelujah, going into this new year. And so if we back up, obviously it's not wrong that they were asking him for this. But he just said, hey, look, what you're asking is really powerful because the path that's before me is persecution. Right? You want to sit at my right and left? And he didn't say that that's not possible. He actually said that's not mine to give. So honestly, there is a seat on the left and right hand of Jesus, but that's for the Father, amen? Right? To give out. But we have to understand that as we're serving Jesus ready, we have to be ready for persecution. Come on. It's not elevated kind of accolades that, you know, Jesus is after. It is service to death. So this week we just got another report. Brother Beebe was helping us translate the the Bible. Okay? We finally got their language in the four Gospels already this year. Amen. And the Muslim priest said, if you keep it up, I'm going to kill you. And Bibi said, no way. I'm going to keep it up. And I got a picture this week of his dead body. They killed him. You ready? I mean, because that's what we're after when we're following Jesus, right? But that's not the end, amen? Because the report says that now Bibi is in his forever home, amen? They were refugees. They were without a home, without a country. But you know what? Now he's got a home. Now he's got a country, amen? He's our second martyr of that people group since August. The one in August, if you remember, he was beaten. He went to that other church member's house and he died in her home. You remember this? And then she was accused for killing him. She just finally got released after 5 months of being in prison. Hallelujah. And within those 5 months of being released from prison, five people got saved in there, she said. Amen. She said, I just prayed to Isa, which is the name of Jesus in Islam. I prayed to Isa every day. You know what? He got me out. Amen. You know, if you truly want to serve Jesus, we have to understand that the world ain't going to like it, and we might come under some persecution. Right? There might be some people that don't like us. Amen? There might be some people that might complain to us. There might be some people that fuss at us. But are we ready? And you can only be ready for that if you know that Jesus did it for you first. We're not going into this blindly. We're not just setting ourselves up to be killed, okay? Jesus went that whole way for us, and when we know that, we can have that same great compassion and mercy for the rest of the world to love them to the point of death. You're not going to die for somebody if you don't care about them, amen? If you really, truly don't love them like Jesus, you won't do that. You won't put yourself through that. I don't want to get ahead of myself. It's about the theme of the year, but I don't know what's going to happen, y'all, but I know God's in it, amen? And then they're pretty boastful. They're like, well, we're able to handle it. Bring it on, right? You know, James and John were very bold to say, we can take whatever kind of persecution comes our way, right? They were men. They were the men of the men, right? Bring it on. Bring it on. Jesus is like, you'll endure it, but not until I do. We can't serve, guys, unless Jesus first served us and you realize that. And he says, indeed, you will drink that same cup and be baptized with the same baptism. And that baptismo means completely saturated with anxiety, guys. Jesus was completely saturated with grief, suffering, sorrow, all of that for us. Your sin, he was baptized with your sin, wasn't he? All of that, he took on himself first. But then, you know, it displeased everybody else because they're all holier than thou too, aren't they? Do I need to say that again? In verse 24, and when the 10 heard it, they were greatly displeased with the two brothers. Well, that's pretty selfish of them, right? But you know, Jesus calls all of the boys in, right? Y'all come here. Y'all come here. Look at this. He says, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who are great exercise authority over them. Yet it shall not be so among you, but whosoever desires to become great among you, let him be your servant. And whoever desires to be first among you, let him be your slave. Just as I'm fixing to do. Amen? Now, I know the world usually says, I'm the leader, so serve me. Right? I pray I'm never that kind of a pastor, right? I'm the pastor. I'm the man of God. Come on. It happens. It does. I heard it does. It does, doesn't it? It does. The world says, I'm the leader, so serve me. But the Bible clearly is saying here, you serve and you will be a great leader. Amen? In order for us to really think about being in leadership or even be great, the possibility of being a great leader is there, hallelujah. But we have to first be willing to get our hands dirty, amen? God bless you, Nicole Ferguson, amen. I mean, Nicole Ferguson. Bless you too, sister, amen. I guess God knew you needed a praise this morning, amen. You pick up after those babies all day long, hallelujah. Great Sunday school teacher. And Nicole McMahon, too. Hallelujah. Thank you for cleaning the restrooms. Hallelujah, sister. But by golly, if I go in there and I see a piece of paper on the floor, I better pick it up. And I think to myself, well, that's Nicole's job. Amen, Nicole? Yeah. Likewise, men, if you're in your own toilets, pick up after yourselves. Amen, wives? I heard the men giggle. Women? Come on, in order for us to be great leaders, we have to be willing to get our hands dirty. We have to be willing to get in the trenches. We have to be willing to do the work. Hallelujah. But we can't do it. We can't do it unless we know that Jesus has first loved us and served us. So really, we need to be willing to serve to the point of death. That's what Jesus is saying here. Is this Christian thing that we're doing just for accolades? Is it just for pomp and circumstance? What is it for? Are we truly serving our way to our death? You guys ready to die? You ready for the end to come? Are we still in America? Barely. We still living in a godly nation? Barely. We still, hey, folks, come on. We're going through the book of Revelation for the last 2 years. It ain't always going to be peachy king jelly bean. Amen? We need to also be not naive to know that persecution is fixing to come. So are we willing to endure to the end? Are we willing to take it to the end? Are we willing to stay with him till the end? Even if things aren't going as we hope they had been going, or as nicely as we think they should be going. So we really need to be willing to serve to the point of death. But how do we do that, guys? How do we take it to that step? How do we, in our Christian walk, be willing to say, you know what, whatever there is to do, I'm not going to look at somebody else to do it. You know, you know that in ministry, right, David? Right? Somebody else? Somebody else will take care of it? Who's doing that? I don't know them. Right, when it comes to the point that we are the ones there, we're the hands and feet of Jesus, are we not? Amen? Miss Lois, you've been making cupcakes on Wednesday night. God bless you. Amen. You're not doing it to get an accolade, but I'm giving you an accolade. Amen. Hallelujah. We got to be willing not just to do that, but to take it to death. Are we ready to die because he first died for us? We can't take it to that point until we understand that Jesus first did it to us. So the how do we serve to the point of death, that what Jesus is saying we're going to do, we have to understand that Jesus served us to the point of death as a ransom for us. Amen? And not just for us, but for many. You can't help but be a great leader until you know that Jesus served you well all the way to death. And you can't help to be a good leader in your life until you know that Jesus served you to death. When you can do that, men, you will be a great man of God in your own home. Come on. And then you will be a great man of God in the church. Amen. Then you will be a great man of God in the community and in the nation and in the world. But you have to first understand that he died as a ransom. What does that mean? It means that he paid your sin. Hallelujah. You're not good enough for this job, Brother Carl. No, I'm not. You don't have what it takes, but he did it for us. Do you know that he ransomed you? He saved you. He bought you with a price, and it was blood on Calvary. Do you know that he served you? If you know that he served you well, you will be willing and able to love and serve other people among you. Well, Brother Carl, you don't know who I'm dealing with. Well, do you know who Jesus dealt with? He dealt with Judas. Turn your Bibles over to John 13. And if you come back tonight, I'm telling you, there's a lot more here. I hope you come back and listen to tonight about true service and how we should serve one another. But John 13, here Jesus, this is where Jesus washes the feet of his disciples. In verse 13, chapter 13, verse 1, it says, "Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come, that he should depart from this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end." Say to the end. Jesus loved them to the end. What? The end of his life? Amen? End of him going to the cross? But you know, he is the Alpha and the Omega. Hallelujah. If there is no end to him, that means there's no end to his love. Come on. Jesus is the end of everything. Hallelujah. Which isn't really an end at all. Which is great news here. But after supper being ended, the devil having already put in put it into the heart of Judas Iscariot. So already Judas Iscariot is filled with the temptation of the devil. He's already a bad guy, y'all. Even worse than he was. He's already got the temptation in his heart to pass off Jesus. Come on, to sell him out. That's the kind of people Jesus is dealing with. Hallelujah. Well, you don't know who I'm dealing with, Brother Carl. Well, they probably ain't Judas. Maybe close. Simon, who betrayed him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going to God, rose from supper. Do you see that? How is, and now Jesus is fixing to wash the disciples' feet. He knew that Judas was filled with the temptation to betray him. How was Jesus able to get up and serve his disciples? Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going to God. Woo! Come on, y'all. The only ability, the way that Jesus was able to wash, because here we're going to see that Jesus even washes Judas's feet, y'all. He serves him like everyone else. He was only able to do that because he knows he's first receiving from the Father. Woo! Because he's fully God and fully man, is he not? Amen? He knows this, the betrayers among him. Man, if it was me, I might call him out already. I'm not going to serve that job. I'm not going to wash his feet. You forget about that. I know he's going to betray me. If you knew one of your brothers or sisters or somebody in this world was going to betray you, do you think you would wash his feet today? You can't do that unless you know that God serves you first. And Jesus himself, it says this, it says that Jesus knowing, that means it had been given it to him, Jesus knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he had come from God and was going to God, he knew he had a bright future, amen? Come on. He could serve because he himself is really being served by the Father, amen? Come on. If Jesus needed that kind of knowledge to serve Judas, I think we need the knowledge to know that Jesus serves us, loves us, so we can love others. Amen? Amen. And he says this, and he rose up after supper, and he laid aside his garments, took a towel, and girded himself. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel with which he was girdled. Then he came to Simon Peter, and Peter said, "Oh, Lord, you're washing my feet?" Jesus answered and said to them, "What I am doing you do not understand now, but you will know after this." Peter said, "You shall never wash my feet." And Jesus said to him, "If I do not wash you, you have no part with me." Simon Peter then said, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." And Jesus said to him, "He who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean, and you are clean. But not all of you, for he knew who would betray him. Therefore, he said, you are not all clean." You come back tonight, we'll talk a little bit more about the water and the word and the washing of the word over us to cleanse us and clean us. Because we're walking in the water. Like, look, Jesus hadn't died on the cross yet, had he? Okay? But he already knows that his sin is going to completely bathe, completely redeem, completely ransom all of his disciples. Amen? But a lot of times our feet need washing, amen? Why do y'all come to church? Get my feet washed. Because you're walking out there in the world and your feet get dirty, don't they? You are righteous, hallelujah. You're sanctified, you're holy, set apart, ransomed by Jesus Christ, hallelujah. But you've been walking in the world all week. Why is it important to come to church? Be washed by the word. Wash those feet off a little bit, amen? Jesus says, you don't have any part of me if you don't let me do that. We need to let Jesus' water, Jesus' word, wash over us, keep our toesies even clean. Amen? Sometimes you get that lint between your toes. Little sin between your toes. Come on, little world between your toes. Because we're out there, we're walking. It's important that we gather. This year, I pray that you guys commit to staying in church. Hallelujah. Keep that water being poured over you, whether it's in our relationships with one another or whether it's in Sunday school or whether it's right now me doing this. We need to continually, you know, allow that water, the Word of God, to wash over us. Hallelujah. We need to serve one another like that. That's how Jesus is serving them, by allowing that water to wash over them. Come back tonight. We'll dive more into that.
But he says this, he who is bathed needs only to be washed his feet, but it is completely clean. And you are clean, but not all of you. He knows that Judas is going to betray him, but he washes his feet anyway. Guys, that's powerful. You know, in ministry, and tonight we're even going to go look at the life of Moses in his ministry. Not everyone's nice to us. Not everyone has our best interest at heart for us. Not everyone's great to deal with. Amen? Guys, you just can't love them the way we should until you feel and know God's love for you. This guy on the phone Wednesday, I gave them the plan of salvation. He received Jesus, hallelujah, over the phone. He began to understand God's love for him. I said, you truly can't love that woman like you should until you know that God loves you. See, we're trying to do life. We're trying to do relationships, trying to love people not the way that God loves us, and it doesn't work. You can't love like we're supposed to. We can't serve like we're supposed to until we know that God's done it for us. And he does it for us continually, all the time. I love my wife, you know, but I just can't love her the way I should until I feel that overwhelming love and service from God first. Amen? You guys got to know that. You got to know that. Otherwise, you're not going to be all the person that you can be without that. And then he says this, for I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is greater than he who has sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. Woo! Come on. So how can I wash y'all's feet this year? Well, with the word of God. Amen. I'll wash your feet. I will only wash your stinking feet by the power of Jesus. Now, I know a lot of charismatic Pentecostal churches, they'll just do it out of habit. Now, the first time somebody washed my feet, I was overseas. And they welcomed us in, and this was in the Philippines, and we were wearing sandals. Our feet were dirty, man. And we came in, they sat us down, and I'm like, oh, what's happening here? They're like, we're going to wash your feet. I'm like, whoa, that's weird. I've heard about this. But they physically were doing it, and it tickled. It was all I could do just to hold my foot there. And my own shame, my own anxiety, my own inadequacies, you know, I just felt weird. You got to let Jesus wash your feet. You got to let Jesus love you first before you try to get up and do it to somebody else. And I know that God this year wants to wash your feet. He wants to love you. He wants to serve you. And he wants you to understand that he's first come to serve you so we can serve to the point of death, you guys. Am I ready to die? No. Am I longing to die? No. I'm eternal, amen. I'm not going to taste death. Look, if you hear that Carl died, don't believe him. Right? I just ain't with my body quite yet. Amen? I've just been disconnected from my flesh for a minute. Amen? It'll be put back together. Hallelujah. But I'm not planning on dying. But I can serve Jesus knowing that that's what's in it. Right? Knowing that that's where it's headed, at some point, y'all are going to die. Amen? And like so many funerals this last year, you can hear people stand up and say they loved Jesus well in this life and loved others well in this life because they knew God's love for them first and knew that Jesus had served them well. And so they could serve well as well. I'm really praying I don't do any funerals this year. I'm praying for that. I'm praying we all have life to the end of the year. Amen. I'm praying. Maybe that's my fourth prayer request. No funerals. I would love to see that. Maybe rapture. Woo! Come on. But no funerals. But we all are going to that place, aren't we? But it's not the end because Jesus is the end and he's eternal. Hallelujah. So with every eye closed, every head bowed, do you know that Jesus loves you? Do you know that he served you first by coming, dying, ransoming you for the forgiveness of all your sins? You need to know that. You can't help to love your wife the way you should. You can't help to love your family the way you should. Heck, you can't even love mom and dad the way you should. You can't love the world the way you should until you know of God's love for you. Do you know he did it for you? He ransomed you. He died on the cross for you to forgive you of all of your sins. Do you know that? Intimately, have you experienced that? And when you do, then, and only then, can you serve like Jesus says, we'll serve. He says, we'll serve to the point of death. We'll serve others with that kind of love and compassion that he's shown us. We will. He says, you will do that. You will have that baptism. You will experience that. You will. You will. So wherever your heart is at this morning, I pray just humbly come to the Lord and say, Lord, none of me, all of you. Forgive me of all of my sins. Forgive me, Lord. Come into my heart. Come into my life. Save my soul. Let me feel that great love. Let me feel that great forgiveness. Let me understand that you served me first. And then from out of that, God, help me. Yeah, help me to do what I'm supposed to do whenever I'm supposed to do it. Just that is an act of love that I know that you've given me first. So church, the altar's open. Come up and pray. Maybe you want to physically pray over those prayer requests, but the altar's open. The time is yours. Come and pray, church. Come and pray. Hallelujah. Miss Rachel's been with us for a long time. She's my sister. We love her. Well, I'm going to embarrass you now. Come on, everyone, stand on up. I'm going to let your handsome husband introduce you to the church. Amen. Miss Norma, come on.
I think all of them know her, and it's about time.
I just want to say this is a prayer answered.
Amen.
By a lot of us.
Rachel desires to be a member of Mercer Baptist Church. She's already a part of us, already part of the family. Amen. Amen. But officially put her on the books. Amen. Amen. Well, brother, I'm going to make you pray us out of here. Can you do that, friend? And come up, love on her. Church, we love you this year. And whatever we can do to serve you, we want to wash your feet. Amen. So bring all of your stinky feet to me. Amen. But just be ready if I bring my stinky feet to you. Come on. But we're glad. Thankful for this day. Rachel, we love you. Amen. Glad that you want to be a part of us. Brother, would you close us in prayer?
Thank you.
Lord, thank you for this day you've given us to gather and love on one another.
Yes, Lord.
Your people, Lord. Thank you for Rachel's decision.
Yes.
With us, Lord.
Thank you,
She's
Jesus.
She's been with us a while, but it's good to be for sure plugged in, Lord.
Yeah.
Part of the family.
Mm.
Lord, I pray that you'd be with us throughout this week.
Mm.
Lord, you know we face many temptations week and week and week. Lord, I pray that you'd keep us protected, keep our eyes focused on you.
Mm.
And bless each and every one of us as we go our separate ways today, Lord.
Jesus' name. Amen, church.
Amen. Amen.
Tell me I was good enough. It doesn't matter what I've done. You pull me closer. Highs and lows and in-betweens. You're the one that's there for me. When I hurt and when I bleed, you make it better. You make it better. You will can't stand. You always find the best in me. Your time is hiding underneath. And every insecurity that I can't cover. I can leave them at the door. You never need me to be more.